Good morning, and welcome to 365 Days of Stories with Theo Mayer. Here we are on day 37. And what I'm going to do is continue the story, the legend of the Moor's treasure. And as you might remember, Perihil, the water carrier, he had, picked this poor, ill man up at the fountain where he typically filled up his water jugs to take out to people. It was late at night. It was one of those warm, sort of sultry evenings. There was a nice moon out, and this ill Muslim was the only one that was up there, and he asked Perihil for his help, and Perihil just couldn't refuse him. So onto his donkey he went, and they went down the hill. The Muslim asked to stay at his place. He agreed. He took him there, and his kids all came out because they were excited to see him at the end of the day. And when they saw this turbaned Muslim, they all went running back in and to the house, and out came Perihil's wife, and all the kids were hiding kind of behind her legs, peeking out and looking to see what would happen. And she really, got into it with Perihil. What are you doing, bringing a Muslim, here to our house, especially at this time of the night? You're going to bring the Inquisition down upon us. And she just went on and on. She didn't do it lightly. She was like almost yelling at him. And of course, people took note as that was going on, but Perihil, usually he did everything that his wife asked him to do, but this time he was not going to. He was stiff-necked about the whole thing, and he said, what do you want me to do here? Do you want me to turn this poor ill man out who has no friend nor home? And so he helped him down off of the donkey and helped him inside, and in the coolest part of the house, he laid down a mat and got a sheepskin for him, and now here the Muslim lay sick. And Perihil's wife went back in and got the kids settled back down. Now Perihil did everything that he could to make his guest comfortable. And as he was there tending to him, the man suddenly began to shake violently with convulsions and was completely often in this world of body sensation and pain, to the point where he couldn't communicate with Perihil at all. And when he came out of it, he said, "I'm afraid this is it. I'm afraid I'm about to pass to the other world. This is it," he said. And he said, "My friend," because it was clear to him that Perihil was trying to do everything that he could for him, and his kindness was not going ignored. He saw it. And so he said to Perihil, "If I pass, I want you to have this treasure that I have." And he opened up his cloak, and there bound against his body was a small box. And he took this box off of his body and and put it down on the floor between them. He says, I want you to have this if I die. And then he put his cloak back on, and as he's putting his cloak back on, he was about to say something more to Perihil when these violent convulsions returned. And he began to shake, and they went on until the poor Muslim expired. Well, now you can imagine Perihil's wife really went off. This is what we get for you trying to be a good doer out there and helping any poor soul that comes along. Look at what we have now. We have a dead Muslim in our house. Certainly, this is the end for us. What will our children do? Because certainly it will be the gallows for us. And if it's not the gallows, in the days that come, there's going to be courts and people are going to be after us, and we're going to completely lose any kind of status that we've had at all living in this town. This is what we give for that. Well, Perihil, again, kind to a fault, he almost repented for having done what he did. But he knew in his heart that this is what we are here for, is to help each other out. Laws or no laws, he had not murdered the Muslim. He'd only reached out to him in kindness. And certainly, all will be well. Well, he began to think, and suddenly it struck him that it was still night. He thought, my wife, here's what we must do. We will load him on to the donkey, and I will take him out of town to the Zinwal River, and there, on its sandy banks, I will bury him. No one will know the better. She liked this idea. They rolled him up in the mat that Perihil had laid out for him, the one that he had expired on. And the two of them, with some struggle, were able to lift him up onto the donkey's back. And now, off into the night, Perihil went in the direction of the Zinwal River, where he would bury the poor Muslim in the sand. Now, across the street from where Perihil and his wife and children lived, there was a man living there. Padrugo was his name. He was a barber. And Padrugo was not just a barber. All right. Today, maybe there aren't so many barbers the way there were even 30 years ago or 40 years or 50 years ago, but barbershops were places where people talked, information was shared, people hung out, even when they didn't need to have their hair cut. And there was a constant inflow and outflow for the barbers of men that would share information. Well, Padrugo did not just have a barbershop where people came in, but he also had private clients who he would see quite regularly. One of them was the alcalde, or one of the alcaldes. An alcalde is kind of like a mayor. And so this man, the alcalde, was one of Padrillo Padrugo's special clients. And every morning he would go to the house of the alcalde and he would shave his face with the typical straight razor that was used then. And Padrillo Padrugo was a kind of a mischief maker and a gossiper, and come on, what else do we need to say? He's one of those people that just talked. He always wanted information. He always embellished stories to make them worse or more than they were. He was always getting into other people's business. And he lived across the street, and he had heard when Peregil had returned very late at night with his donkey. He'd heard everything. He had a little small window that he would look out of his house to keep aware of the goings-ons around him. It was even said that when he slept with one eye open and one ear uncovered so that he could hear and see still anything that might happen. Well, he had peeked out of his little loophole and he had seen Peregil with this Muslim, this turbaned man. And he had seen Peregil help him into the house. He'd heard the commotion of his wife. And he took great interest in what was going on. And he heard Peregil and his wife as they began to load the Muslim, the dead Muslim, the deceased Muslim onto the donkey now. And again, he had been watching, because ever since Peregil came home with this Muslim late at night, which was very odd, he had been peeking out of his loophole every like 5 minutes to see what was going on. Well, I can tell you that when that expired Muslim was loaded onto the donkey, Padrugo was on it. Oh my gosh. He was worked up into a frenzy. Now he really had something to take note of. This was not just some little gossipy thing. This was perhaps robbery, murder, and now what? Pedrillo Pedrugo could only think it must be burial now. And so he quickly put on his clothing, had taken off his night clothing, came down, and as Peregil went out of the town toward the Zinal River with his Muslimman in tow, Pedrillo Pedrugo followed at a distance. He saw Peregil dig and a hole, put this bundle that looked like a dead body into the hole, and then cover it and turn and come back. Pedrillo Pedrugo, of course, did not allow Peregil to see him and started on his own way home much more quickly than Peregil could go home with the donkey. And we'll leave the story there. And tomorrow I'll continue and we'll find out what happens next. Have a good rest of your day. Thanks for joining.